So, before we go into anything, we just want to start tonight by sharing, obviously we started already, that we're going to share some testimonies of what God is doing. Some of us went out last night to the fair, the DuPont State Fair, and we saw some awesome stuff. But even before that, this week, really every week, we get to see Jesus do amazing stuff because the Holy Spirit is on earth, and Jesus is alive, and He wants to move through His body, and tonight He wants to move through you, and if that's not been happening, He wants to fill you up and stir you up so that you can walk as Jesus walked in every way. And that's not just to have a good character, which is very important, but it's also to do the works that Jesus did, because that's part of what He said those who believe on Him would do. So Jesus is going to stir you up tonight, and testimony is one of the ways He does it. And so we're going to share a video right now of an awesome story that happened Tuesday. And we've seen a lot of miraculous stuff. And I've seen more probably dramatic, a couple dramatic things happen in one setting in terms of like one miracle. But this week may be this particular story the most dramatic. I've seen multiple things happening to one person in one setting. Donna was there with me, and Lydia was there. It's actually Donna's contact for this person. This person contacted Donna and just saw actually her testimony on Facebook, how she was sharing about how God transformed her life, and which tells you that God is for Facebook, if you use it right. And so this lady drove from 2 hours away to receive from Jesus, and she had never heard the gospel, believe it or not. She grew up hearing about Jesus, but never really heard how Jesus loves her and died for her because she's so valuable that He would want her. She just heard her very religious version of who God was. So she came to this on Monday night, and by the way, we have a healing room on Tuesday night. And if for some reason you can't make it, we try to make exceptions if it's really necessary. On other nights, you can make appointments with us through that healing room. We have a healing room Facebook page. And if you need personal prayer one-on-one, it's a great time to do that. And any of our people who have walked with us, either through discipleship or just we know as people are really solid in the Lord, we come together and take turns and just pray for people and let loose. And Jesus does amazing things. So if you need something in your body, you don't get it taken care of on a Sunday night or in your home, then we have that available. But this particular lady came on a Monday night just because she's from 2 hours away. It was the only time she could come. And I'm trying to think if there's anything else I need to give you a heads up about. So she walked in the door, just in case you don't hear the video clearly or for some reason. She walked in the door with a broken wrist, a wrist thing on. And it was pretty severely broken, actually. Her bone was protruding, not completely out of the flesh, but it was poking to the point you could see it. And you'll see that on the phone, the picture from the night before. And then she's also completely blind in the right eye, 100% blind, and mostly blind in the other one for 3 years because of an autoimmune issue. And let me just say before that, well, I'll finish up with explaining why some of that got healed. But it was a progressive thing as the night went on, but it was actually really condensed and short. I mean, all this happened within what? Really, the healing part.
An hour, 2 hours?
Well, I mean, the healing part was 15 minutes. And we just listened to her a little bit, and then we shared the gospel with her. The talking was the longest part, as usual. and then Jesus was a lot quicker than our talking. So... anyway, watch this video. It's awesome.
My name is Gina, and I received the Lord today.
And so you came in with also a broken wrist?
Correct.
And tell us what happened to your wrist real quick.
I was in a rollover accident with a side-by-side ATV. The impact from the driver landed on me and broke my wrist. Here's the picture to actually show what the bone looked like. As of last night.
So this is a picture of last night.
Yeah, the bone that's about to protrude through the skin.
And you said they were going to put pins in your...
They were talking about putting pins back in it, doing surgery.
Okay. And he was in pain from the very moment you had the accident all the way up until about 30 months ago.
Yeah, I've been living on pain medicine for the past week.
Okay. And you had this wrist brace on?
Correct.
And now, look at your wrist. Yes, there's no pain?
There's no pain.
Lift this up for us. And there's no way you could do that.
No, I couldn't even feel myself.
Okay. And then the other thing is you couldn't see very well out of either eye.
Correct.
Right? Because of what they said was an autoimmune brain issue.
Correct.
And you couldn't read very well, especially out of the right eye.
The right eye was completely blind.
And tonight God healed your eyes.
Correct.
And you are able to read normally out of both eyes, right?
Absolutely.
Okay, so I'm going to hold this phone, and I want you to just read what that says. Cover one of your eyes.
For the joy of all times. Because for rejoice in the Lord always, and again I say rejoice.
Okay, do your other eye.
Just, I used to hate that verse.
It's okay. Crying is okay. Go ahead. Try it.
It's because I love God, but I was also heavily wrapped in stuff and relationships. I was looking for something beyond what I had to be content.
Yeah. Wow. So Jesus just had a whole overhaul on you, and you drove from how far?
Almost 2 hours.
Awesome. All right. Well, we praise the Lord. We give Him all the glory for it, right?
Yes.
Praise Jesus is Lord.
Praise Jesus.
I just wanted to share a little bit about what happened last night. Had some great stuff happen at DuQuoin State Fair. So if any of you were there and seen the pictures of people being ministered to, that was pretty awesome. Check out our page on The Loft and just check out all the different things that are happening. And know that if you're a Christian, if you're a born-again believer, that you have every right and opportunity to go out there and do the very same thing. So none of us are special, extraordinary type people. We're just people that love the Lord just like everybody here. Who loves the Lord in here? Woo! Who's born again?
Amen.
Alright, well, you guys have every opportunity to go out and do this same thing that we're getting ready to talk about. So, as some of you know, my name's Carl, and I get to go out and I get to travel a little bit, and as I'm out and I'm traveling, just try to be obedient to the Lord and listen to what he's saying. There's times that I go out and I don't hear a whole lot of anything, and there's times that I do go out and I hear some things that he's going to tell me. So I was at the hotel last night, and I walked in and walked by this young lady, and we just made eye contact and said hello, and walked by her, went up to my room. I came back down, I was getting ready to go to the gym and work out, and she didn't notice me, because she was like, well, hello, how are you? You know, because I was just in different clothes. I said, I'm good, just going to get a workout in. And so as I walked by her, though, I heard the name Elizabeth. Okay, so it was really weird just to hear that pop into my mind. So let me back up because that's not exactly the right order. So I go, I work out, I come back up to my room. She makes eye contact with me, I go to my room, and then I'm getting ready to go to Popeye's Chicken to eat. I like Popeye's Chicken and Biscuits, one of my favorite places. So, it kind of equaled itself out, you know? Workout, Popeye's Chicken and Biscuits, lots of calories. It works out. Gun show. So, as I'm leaving to go to Popeye's, I walk by her and I look at her. Her name's Kendall, actually. And I look at her and I hear Elizabeth. I'm like, and I just keep walking. There's a lot of people in line getting ready to get checked in. So the whole way to Popeye's and sitting at Popeye's eating and stuff, I'm like, Lord, this is tough. You're wanting me to ask her about Elizabeth. And I said, I start questioning the Lord and asking him, who's Elizabeth? Because he'll talk to you. He'll let you know who Elizabeth is.
Yeah.
And sometimes he'll just withhold the information just for you to be obedient and just ask who Elizabeth was. So I'm sitting there and I'm asking the Lord exactly who Elizabeth is. And he said, ask her about Lizzie specifically. I'm like, okay. So I come back and there's a lot of people in line still checking into the hotel. And I kind of wait for the line to dwindle down. And I come up to the desk after everybody's gone because I didn't want to interrupt her work. And I said, because I don't know, for whatever reason, I'm a little intimidating. And when I walk up to people and I'm like, hey, do you know Elizabeth? I'm in my workout gear too, you know? And this young lady is like, who's this guy, you know? That's what I'm thinking in my mind. She's thinking, man, this guy's crazy. So I said, hey, can I ask you a question? I said, sometimes the Lord gives me these impressions, and I just wanted to ask you about Elizabeth. Do you know any Elizabeths? She said, well, yeah, I actually know a lot of Elizabeths. I'm like, oh, okay. And I was like, Lord, I know you spoke to me. I know you spoke to me. And I said, actually, do you know somebody really close to you that's Elizabeth? And she was kind of like, this guy's crazy. I don't think I want to tell him who Elizabeth is. And I was like, it's just somebody that's close to you. Who's Elizabeth? She goes, it's my sister. Pretty awesome. So her name is Caitlin Elizabeth, but she goes by Caitlin. Or I'm sorry. Her name's Caitlin. She goes by Elizabeth. And then she says, we call her Elizabeth, and we call her Lizzie for short. So as soon as she said that, I grab her by the hand. I reach over the thing and I smack her hand, you know, because I'm excited. You know, I said, you know what? I said, God is so interested in you that he would send a complete stranger to talk to you and just show you love. And I said, not only that, he loves your sister too. And he's reaching out to you and your sister. And she started crying. And she said, you don't know how much this means to me. She said, I'm not recovering, but I just found out that I don't have cancer anymore. So I give her another high five, you know, to the side because nobody's around. And then everybody's walking through and we're both crying at that moment, you know, because I'm just excited about what God had shared. But the reason why I'm telling you that, Josh told me to come up and kind of share that tonight. But it is so exciting to hear from the Lord, is it not?
Yes.
And Everybody asks, this is like one of the major questions that I ask and one of the major questions that you all ask. How do you hear the Lord? How many has asked that question before or asked somebody or asked yourself? We all have. How do you hear the Lord? Sometimes this is what I'm going to tell you because this is from personal experience. Elizabeth, the name, it popped in my head. I have no idea. But as I looked at her, I seen Elizabeth. So, I just asked her about Elizabeth. Man, that sound real philosophical and just deep? No, it's not. The Lord's thoughts and your thoughts are connected. And sometimes we're thinking something, and it's actually the Lord telling us what's going on. And then we just step out. We take that risk and we step out. And we share what the Lord's put on our heart. Are we going to miss it sometimes? Yep, we sure are. But if we never practice it, we're never going to know. So if you want to do anything in life and get good at it, you've got to practice it. So if you want to practice hearing from the Lord, just tune your ear and say this. I do this when I go out. I say, Lord, what do you want to share? What do you want to share with me? What do you want to share with somebody else? Because he loves everybody.
Yes.
And he wants them to have a relationship with him. So, just do it. Go out there and be used of God. And like I said in the beginning, the reason why I said what I said in the beginning is all of you can do this. It's nobody special.
Yes.
It's not for pastors. It's not for elders or deacons or anybody else. It's for those that are born again. That has a heart to listen to what the Lord's telling them. So,
tell
God's
the
good.
Tell the end of the story.
Huh?
Tell the end of the story, because that's important.
Oh, about the card?
No, about her sister that
Oh, she said that, sorry, I'm getting ahead of myself. She said that her and her sisters had a strained relationship and that their relationship was growing. So that relationship's being mended. So God had me share all those things just to kind of bring it full circle so that she could be like, okay, God is really speaking to me and he wants that relationship. And she's like, hey, but I'm a Lutheran. And I go, it don't matter. I don't care what you think you are or what title you've given yourself. You're a child of God and he wants a intimate relationship with you. So as I do normally, I just kind of, I've always got business cards. I said, hey, give this business card to your sister and tell her that this guy walked into the hotel that you helped manage and give it to her and just say, hey, there was somebody that came in here that knew your name and that was, and said that God loves you. I don't know what's happened from that, but I know that that seed's going to be planted and those two girls won't be the same again.
Amen.
Good stuff.
Who was with us last night? Raise your hand. Chris, you want to, or Steph, you guys want to come up? She wants you to come up. Well, you may go first and last if you're the only one, so come on. Just share one of the stories.
I just shared one. My favorite one was, I think I was with Megan. I asked her to help me pray for this older guy. He was drinking and he was just walking, and I just went up to him, you know, and asked him if I could pray for him. Because I noticed he was kind of like walking with a limp, so I noticed that his leg was hurting. So I just say, hey, how you doing? You know, my name is Chris, and I asked him what his name was. And from that point on, I just told him, you know, Jesus loved you very much, and I was just wondering if I could pray for you, you know, just humbly asked him that. And he said, sure, you can pray for me. And so I prayed for him, and I asked him if he could take a few steps, and he did. And, you know, he found out he was healed. And I said, you know, you healed because of Jesus Christ loved you very much. It was nothing of myself. I'm not special. Jesus loved you. And he just wanted to, he thought about you today. And that's why he sent me here to pray for you so you can be healed. And then, then from that point on, he just went on talking about different things that happened to him in church. I guess he got hurt in church or something like that. And just, it was a lot of condemnation, you know. He very guilty about some things that he did, you know, because he had a problem with drinking, you know. I told you I didn't even smoke alcohol. And I just said, you know, Jesus loved you the same regardless. I mean, people struggle with things, but we just have to be honest with God. You know, I told even myself when I had addictions, I just asked God to help me with this. You know, I stopped trusting in my own self to get over it, and I asked God to help me with it. So from that point on, with truly being honest with God, it wasn't a program or anything like that. He just really helped me, just broke it off, that bondage off my life. Now I don't have to struggle with it anymore. But anyway, I just told him that simple story, what happened with me, and he just went on and he found his wife. I didn't know anything about that. I was with Josh and Lydia, and we was talking to somebody else, praying for other people, and he got his wife, and he just told her, and she was very happy. It was just amazing, you know, to see what Jesus did in their life. So anyway, that's it.
I don't want to keep talking because I want him to share. But probably the coolest thing, when we first got there, I kept on envisioning like a group of kids. You know, when you go to the fair, they're always like huddling around. Teenagers are like huddled in on the phones and stuff. So I was like, man, about a year ago we watched a YouTube clip about this couple going to Disney World, and they had like this group of kids all in a circle, and they were just like praying for them all to feel the Holy Spirit. I was like, man, I want to see that. Like, this is a perfect opportunity. But so as the night went on or whatever, we went back to talk to this other girl that had an encounter, and there was this group of kids all in a huddle, and Chris saw this little boy. He had like a foot thing on or whatever, so he goes over and starts initiating conversation, prays for the little boy's foot and stuff, and I'm like, do it. And they're like, do what? I'm like, just get them around. They're all staring at us anyways, and they're kids. So they, Josh and Chris, get the kids, and they're all holding hands. And Josh starts praying for Holy Spirit to come and encounter these kids. And I mean, they're all in a circle holding his hands. Like, some of them are like looking like, what the crap are these people doing? But So they just prayed and they blessed him. And then later, they all walked away and we were sitting there talking to this other guy. And then they came back and sat next to this table, this picnic table kind of near us. And I'm standing there talking to Amanda and I hear the little boy that Chris prayed for with the little cast or whatever on his foot. And he goes, "Did you guys feel that? I felt something. Did you feel that?" And they were like, the kids, you know how they are, they won't admit, you know, because they're afraid, they're whatever. But it was just so cool, just even taking that step, and I know that they felt something. I don't care if they said that they did or not. Like, you can just tell it. They were all, like, quiet, and that little kid was like, "I felt something." And that was just, it was so cool because, I don't know, just that age, like, teenagers, they're open, that, from, like, 12 to 19, it's like, if you can just stop them, they'll listen to you, you know, because you're adults. But it was just so cool just to see that. I mean, in the middle of DuQuoin, these kids in a circle holding hands and just praying Holy Spirit over them. It was just amazing. I want to see that more. But I don't want to keep talking.
Keith or John, tell one story if you can.
One story?
Yeah.
Real quick. All of us are
telling you one. Well,
two stories, please.
Keith led five people to Jesus on Saturday. And Wednesday, I went out with this lady who's laying on the floor. It's her birthday today in the plaid shirt. You should sing "Happy Birthday" to her, said maybe. But I'll let you do it because I'm not a singer. Anyway.
I think that would be more enjoyable if you did it. More entertaining. You do that now or after your story?
All right. So we go out Wednesday God did some stuff and we ended up talking to this lady who had a security vest on and she had this bracelet one down her leg. She said she had three botched back surgeries and on a 0 to 10 scale that I kind of use, some people do. She said her pain was a level 12 constantly. And she didn't have feeling in the back of her legs. And Amanda just started praying for her, commanded the feeling to go back into her legs. And then I prayed for her, asked the Holy Spirit to come and touch her, you know, and commanded her back to be healed and the pain to go. And asked her how she was doing. And she said, it's a three.
Why are you talking to me?
It had lowered, you know, and then she says, I'm wiggling my toes, and I said, "You couldn't wiggle your toes before?" "No, I couldn't wiggle them for 3 years. I couldn't even feel my feet. I broke my ankle," and she went on and on and on about these back surgeries, and I said, "Well, how's the pain in your back?" "Well, it's a three." "Well, Jesus prayed for somebody twice, so let's pray for you again." We prayed for her again, and she says the pain's gone.
Praise
Jesus
God.
Healed all of her pain in the back. And she's checking out her toes. She's wiggling her toes. And then she says she feels this tingling in the back of her legs. She hasn't felt anything in the back of her legs for 3 years. And I said, "That's the Holy Spirit. He's healing your legs." She didn't give her life to Jesus, but she got touched by his love. So, anyway, here you go. One more. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, Amanda Smiley. Happy birthday to you. Woo! Speech.
You know, we're laughing and we're having a good time, but I want to honor John because I saw him, I was with him all day Saturday, and there was the veterans nursing home bus came and these guys in wheelchairs came down. John rushed to this guy in the wheelchair, laid hands on it. The guy said he hurt, his shoulder was hurting. John laid hands on his shoulder, and the guy was a little bit, nothing really happened initially. But the second time, John persevered, second time he laid hands on his shoulder, the Lord hit that elderly gentleman, and he said his shoulder was better. So I want to give honor to this man. This man, he's like a bulldog, and nothing can take that away. We love him.
Now, last year this time, I was about as dead as a doornail. God started speaking to me 316 for 9 months. Does he ever speak to you in numbers? He was saying 316. I'd see it everywhere. Everybody else was seeing 000 and 111, and I was seeing 316 everywhere I turn around. I said, God, what's 316? Well, John 3:16, Revelation 3:16, Zephaniah 3:16, I don't know. But the Holy Spirit was saying, come to me, all you labor and heavy laden, I will give you rest. And he was saying, call out to me, and I said, God, I don't even have a willing heart to come to you. I don't have a willing heart to even worship you, Jesus. I don't even have a willing heart to have a willing heart. So, and he starts like, well, you brought back a memory of a friend saying a long time ago, if you don't have a willing heart, then, oops, I looked at him, and you can ask, and he will give you, you know, because ask and you shall receive. So, I did, and Jesus, he came. And look at this guy over here, man. He is so on fire. He loves Jesus. He loves Jesus. Don't you love Jesus? Everyone behind the screen, he loves Jesus too. Okay, somebody else needs to take the microphone. Okay. Here you go, buddy.
There's three people that's got something wrong with your left hand in this book. Is that right? What three people have got something wrong with their left hand? There's one. No. Because we are in the season of Av. That season of Av is a particular thing. I don't want to go into it real deep because in the season of Av, many bad things happened. Okay? And that's not what we're about. But in the season of Av, is the left hand is knowing what the right hand is doing. Because there's also something about that that's released that's negative. You know, the left hand should know what the right hand's doing. So if there's something going on with your left hand tonight, there's supposed to be three people who gets prayer over that left hand. And it's not always about pain. It's not always about something that's wrong. But it could be about some part of what God wants to do with you in the next season. And many times it is because we're in a transformational place right now. And the next about 30 to 60 days, there's going to be big changes. So if that's you, check me out.
All right, anybody else got a significant testimony? It's a dangerous thing to ask in a big group of people. You got one?
I feel like I should share this for some reason because it was last year, and I was selling insurance, going door to door, and I was in Metropolis, and I started getting these words of knowledge, which one of the ways the Lord speaks to me, like Carl was talking about, was I feel pain in my body, and I know that it's not mine. And So I knew that it was for someone that I was about to encounter. And the first lady that I knocked on her door, it's this 89-year-old lady, and she's sitting in her chair, and she motions me to come in because her walker is beside her chair, and it's just easier for her to motion to me to come in than for her to get up and answer the door. And she was 89 years old, so she didn't qualify for anything that I'd sold as far as insurance was concerned. And I was like, okay, God, well, and so I just started asking her about these words of knowledge. I said, hey, do you have a problem with your knees and with your ankle and your low back? And she said, yeah, I haven't been able to walk in like 7 years, I think is what she said. And I was like, well, God just spoke to me while I was on the way here and told me that you had all these problems. Would it be all right if I prayed with you? And she said, yeah. And so I prayed with her right there in her living room. And by the time that we was done, she was doing laps around her living room without a walker. This is an 89-year-old woman. God wants to meet people where they are. She didn't even have to get up out of her recliner. God wants to send you to reach people where they are. Some of them don't even realize that there's a God out there that can touch them, that can save them, that cares about them. You are supposed to be the hands and the feet. And so whenever God sends you somewhere and you get that impression, like Carl says, or you start feeling pain in your body that you know is not yours, and you're like, don't be dense and say, oh, well, I need to go get that checked out. Think. Start to key in, because God's speaking all the time, just whether your radio starts tuned to the right frequency or not. And I just felt impressed to share that with you so that you guys will begin to start to be aware. God, are you speaking to me? Am I feeling something? Am I hearing something? And I'm not saying that it happens all the time, but it happens a lot more than you give it credit for, is what I'm saying. I mean, there's a lady named Marie in Metropolis that is grateful that I was sensitive enough to key in. And she shared a testimony at her little Methodist church that she goes to, and everybody was hollering and shouting and praising God. Wait, no, it wasn't Methodist, it was Baptist. And she whenever I was dialoguing with her, she's like, well, it's kind of creepy. I'm like, no, it's not creepy. It's just God cares about you. And was that okay, Josh? I mean, I know that it was from last year. It wasn't this year. But, I felt like it was relevant for some reason. I just felt like somebody needed to hear that.
It's too late now, anyway.
It's true. I'll take my lashes later, I guess. Woo! Uh-oh.
Eddie's speaking, and everybody else here brought up something.
Josh.
You don't need to wait for a word of knowledge. And, I learned this last fall, or this spring or something, I don't remember what it was, but people that have been on their feet all day, cashiers, their feet get sore. Your feet sore. Just ask people, do you have pain in your body? And people will tell you if they've got some kind of problem going on. And you just come to them in love and you just ask them, You don't need a word of knowledge. 95 probably or more percent of the time, I don't have a word of knowledge. I don't get nothing. And sometimes I get something when I'm praying for people. Occasionally God shows me something, but it's usually, you just ask people if there's something I can pray for you for. And, you know, then you can just pray for him and expect God will bless him. And he will. He will. Because you have the same authority as I do, and Josh, and anybody else. God bless you.
I don't have anything super complicated for you tonight. What?
Oh, well.
But, I do have something. Amen. I want to share a story, too, from last night. And this might encourage you, because there's good and bad to it. Well, it wasn't perfect, I'll just say that. I was walking around with these guys, too, and I saw this guy on crutches. And John's actually right. There's, for me, anyway, I don't get words of knowledge for people just walking by them very often. Most of the time when it happens to me, for me, it's when I'm actually laying hands on somebody or praying for them. But we were walking by, and I look for ailments and crutches and wrists and or just... Sometimes the Lord will highlight people, and that happens too. Or you'll just see a downtrodden thing on their face, and you want to love on them. So anyway, we saw this guy on crutches, and that was an easy one. So I walked up to him and just said, "Hey, don't mean to bother you, but..." And by the way, if you're wondering how do you approach people, that's usually like the biggest question. And we've joked about this before, but you don't run up to them and go, "Let's save the Lord," you know. You just kind of be conversational. And don't walk up to them and try to stab them or put a lighter in their face or something weird, you know, something super spiritual. So I walked up to him and I just said, "Hey man, sorry to bother you, don't want to take much of your time, but we're just out here praying for people and wonder if I saw you had the crush and wonder if I could pray for your leg. What happened?" And I'll ask him what happened because they always want to tell you what happened, like problem-wise. They're always going to tell you problems. So he said, "I don't know, I injured it doing something." See, I don't even remember what he said because here's the sneaky thing. While people are telling me, I am listening. If they're telling me something from like deep from their heart, listen, okay? Don't, you know, listen to people's heart. But if they're just telling you the problem, sometimes I take that moment to kind of just be like, "What are you saying, Jesus, right now?" And so I listened to him. But anyway, he had an issue with that. And so we prayed for his ankle, and he didn't know God at all. And so God touches his ankle. His pain goes down, and it's like almost all the way gone, which ticks me off because I want everything to go instantly now. But it's okay. Sometimes that happens, and you deal with it, and you go for it again. So I pray twice, and it goes down even more. And now he's really, you know, like, "This is crazy. That's weird, crazy." And so we just immediately start sharing the gospel. So I share Jesus with him for about 60 seconds. Simple. And, you know, I could just tell, like, he was ready to go. And I said, "Well, God," you know, we're standing there, a couple of us, saying, "God loves you. He wants to encounter you. And when you're laying in bed tonight, I want you to, it's up to you, man. We're not here to twist your arm into a prayer, because I can tell you don't really want to do that right now. But God is after your heart. He healed your leg because he wants your heart. And when you're laying in bed tonight, you talk to him." He says, I will. He's totally sincere. It was an awesome moment. So he turns to walk away, and as he's walking away, I hear in my heart, and as they're saying, it's like almost, you know, if you're not tuned in, you just kind of let it pass. But I hear, clear as a bell in my heart, "Going to the military." And he's worried, but he's already walked away. And I've already bugged him, and I'm kind of like overly conscientious about people, and sometimes, and almost to my detriment every once in a while. And, yeah, well, he's walking away holding his crutches, so that was cool. But I didn't want him. He's literally, and he looks back at us, you know, like from a mile away, I can see him. He's totally freaked out. The two girls that were with him, they don't know what to think. But I heard that, and I thought, well, he's too far gone. And if you've ever been to DuPont State Fair, I don't know where everybody comes from, because it's DuCoin. But there's like thousands and thousands just coming by you, left and right, like New York City on the street. And again, does anybody know where they come from? I don't get it. It's State Fair in DuCoin. It's like bands are playing from 20 years ago. That's the last stop before you really need to hang it up. You need to hang it up before that. When you go on the fair circuit, you're in trouble as a band. Anyway, so it's true. So anyway, we go another hour and we're walking around praying for people. And this guy, he's... I see him all of a sudden. I'm like, this is a miracle just to see him. And so I run up to him. And I chase him down. I go, hey, I'm so sorry to bother you again. So he turns around and goes, hey. And I said, how's your leg doing? He goes, it's still. Yeah, so that's crazy. And I said, well, I didn't say something to you I should have said. And this may sound weird, but are you going to the military by any chance? He said, yeah, I'm thinking about going to the military. And I said, ah, oh, thank you, Lord. And it was perfect because I could tell. I don't know how to perceive this, but I just could tell he needed like a back-to-back moment. Like, it was a seed that we planted, but God wanted to water it, boom, boom. Because the second impact had, I think, even a greater impact. That this guy would chase him down again and have something again that was from God. And so I told him, and he just had this look of shock on his face. And I said, well, man, this is the second time God has reached out to you tonight. Obviously, he wants you. You know, and this guy just walks away. So this is stuff that everybody can do. And if you're a believer in Jesus, I just want to share with you one of the things really practically tonight that will bring you into the things of God even more. Now, it's not just so you can do stuff. It's about the heart of the Father and you connecting. And so in 2 Timothy chapter 1, he says this in verse 3. And you ladies are going to like this verse. So 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 5. So Carl will bring that up in a second. So it says, for I am mindful of the sincere faith within you. This is Paul talking to Timothy, which first dwelt in your grandmother Lois and your mother Eunice, I guess is how you pronounce that.
Yeah.
And I'm sure that is in you as well. So number one, I want you to see there's a beautiful generation. You know, I believe in generational curses, that they do exist in the form of demonic spirits sometimes that follow family lines. And we've had people in the healing room come through, and we break that off by just telling them about the blood of Jesus and how it draws a line in the sand, and we pray over them. And sometimes things come off of them, and it's great. But there's this beautiful generational blessing that can come too. And so I believe this is an example right here, that a generational blessing that comes from believers' family, a grandmother, and then also the mother. These are two women, by the way. And so I don't want to get off on this, and God help me not get totally off on this because I'm passionate about it. But Jesus started a liberation movement around women. He was the original liberation movement for women. And the Jewish culture had so fouled this thing up, women couldn't even testify. They couldn't even tell, you know, if somebody needed to know the truth. They couldn't, nobody could accept their testimony because they're women. And, you know, they're below. And so, this actually still goes on today in our culture, just like racism is prevalent in some areas and all this, you know, but there's this mindset among men in the church too, and God is dealing with it. It's awesome that he's dealing with it. And I see it breaking down more and more, and Jesus is making headway in his church in this way, but it's got to stop.
Amen.
Because Jesus liberated women. Paul says that there is neither male nor female in Christ. Now that doesn't mean you're transgender in Christ.
Amen.
That's a whole other topic there too. But in the context of your importance and your roles, there's neither male nor female. There's neither Jew nor Gentile. Ephesians says he broke down the dividing wall. And he makes one new man. We're one body in Christ. And Jesus says, or through Joel, the Holy Spirit through Joel, that in the last days I will pour out my spirit upon everyone, men and women. And the men and women will prophesy. The men and women will see visions and have dreams.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
So happening right here. One time, by the way, in my apartment when we first started, I had asked the Lord over and over. It's like, interrupt me, Lord. Anything you want to do, Holy Spirit, interrupt me. And so a couple weeks in, I get up and I'm starting to share from the Word, and these three women just drop to the ground simultaneously on my hardwood floor in the back of the place, and they just start going out in the Spirit. And all three of them are just
yelling in tongues while they're on the ground. And it's not a message in tongues. I'm not here to teach a discipleship lesson on how tongues are used. You can come on Thursday night. Here's a little plug. But it wasn't a message in tongues, so there wasn't an interpretation issue. It's not a prophecy that's going forth to the church. It was actually an encounter they were having, them and God, as a sign, and the tongues is even a sign. And then, though, even so, they started prophesying. And this is noisy. This is disruptive in a manly, in our human sense. And yet it's totally God, because they're both coinciding, telling us stuff they're seeing when they come out of it. And I just learned, like, if you don't let those things happen, you're not going to have as many people get saved.
Yeah.
If you don't let those things happen, you're not going to have as many people get healed.
Right.
You have to let Jesus do what he wants to do.
Right.
Are we in control or is God in control?
Right.
What is order? You know, the order is God's.
Yeah.
It's his idea.
Yeah.
And 1 Corinthians 14 talks about order in terms of prophecy. And we've blanketed this thing, order, to mean whatever we choose it to be. And meanwhile, God's standing here going, I'd love to do something if you just get out of the way.
Right.
Because I'll tell you what's out of order. When you have nobody get saved, when you have nobody get healed, when you have nobody get delivered,
what?
When there are no heart transformations,
what?
And we just sit here like bumps on logs and a bunch of stoic men and women in suits and ties and sometimes even separated in our hearts or physically. That is not what Jesus intended. That's religion. It's dead. It's lifeless. It's fruitless. He said, you shall know them by the fruit.
Come on.
And I don't want to have anything to do with a system or even in here where we start having our own traditions that limit the flow of the Spirit. I'm not afraid of what you think. I'm not afraid if it's your first time here. Because I trust God with you more than I trust myself.
All right.
If God does something, and it's really him. Now, we don't want fleshly stuff that's fake. But if it's really him, who am I to tell him what clothes he gets to wear each service?
Right
now, you don't get to wear that, Jesus. We're not doing that. Right now, I don't really like that, what you're doing. It might scare somebody. Is Jesus not aware of who's in the room?
Right.
He is. Who am I to tell him, Jesus, someone might get scared? If it's really him, do you think he's that stupid? The King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, the omniscient God who knows every single person in the room, all your backgrounds, where you're from, how long you've been in it.
Come on.
How many hairs on your head? He knows. And so if he's doing something, and it's truly him, and it's the Spirit of God, obviously he doesn't care. But the greater truth is, the kingdom of God is seeds. And he plants a seed. And even the person who gets angry and leaves because they're offended by the Spirit of God, Jesus even says that the cross is an offense.
Yeah.
He will offend your mind to reveal what's in your heart.
Yes.
If in your heart you are not truly after the Spirit of God, he will offend your mind. Okay?
Come on. 3 years ago, I was in Murfreesboro, Tennessee, speaking of this. I gave my life over to the Lord, and I was going for everything. I was losing control. I wanted everything that he had for me, no matter what it sounded like, what it looked like. I was going there to encounter that. So just going along with what he said, I was in the middle of this women's conference, and the very first night, the Holy Spirit started moving in a way that I had not seen, and it offended me. I was sitting back there with my hands crossed. I was like, what are these ladies? These are some freaking kooky ladies. Like, what is happening?
Oh, yeah.
And this woman was preaching, and she was actually had some cookies that she was selling for the youth ministry to raise money for a trip. And so as these women were coming forward to hand out these cookies, they couldn't even grab the cookies because they were falling to the ground under the presence of the Lord. And I was sitting in the back saying, okay, I said that I wanted you. I said I wanted to lose control. I wanted everything that you had for me, but I don't want that. But you know what happened? When I walked out of that church, I was grieving. I was upset. Me acting that way made me sick because I wanted that encounter and I felt like I missed it. I missed an encounter with God and it made me sick. man, in that hotel room, I got down and I said, Lord, I'm so sorry. Just because it looks a certain way, it sounds a certain way, and I can't comprehend it because I haven't seen it before, I am so sorry. That next day I went there, and I went up straight to the altar. I put my hands in the air, and I just started praising him. I go, okay, I want that to happen to me because I missed out. Whatever that was, I don't care. Of course I was trembling. I'm like, I don't know what that was, but I'm here. And I just started worshiping, and it was like this warm love, just this tangible liquid love started pouring all over my head, from my head to my toes, and I started shaking and I was singing, and then all of a sudden I wasn't saying words anymore. It was like this stuff that's inside of you that you can't say words to, you can't put words to, you can't even wrap your head around it, but it's just in you, you've got to get it out. That's what tongues is. I'm not going to preach on tongues, but that's what happened to me. It was like he took my own self away and replaced it with his spirit, and I was able to get all of this junk up that I was holding in with my arms crossed in the back, and I received something more powerful. I got baptized Holy Spirit, speaking in tongues, and it was like the most amazing thing I've ever experienced. So just speaking with that, whatever you see, you don't know what God's doing. If they're laughing, he's replacing it with joy. If they're crying, he's healing their heart. So man, don't ever sit with your arms crossed. Have an open heart, have an open mind, because God wants to do something radical inside of you that is way better than anything that you can cross your arms to. So just open them up. Let him do what he wants to do, because it's so much better than a stale heart and leaving out that door just the way you came in. You said it!
The very nature of God is what? Supernatural. Is God in any way natural?
No.
So, to encounter God, you have to get outside of the natural. Right? By default. Because if you don't encounter God. And I found out there's no easing into this thing. I watch it happen over and over and over. People tried it. Well, we're just going to ease into that, brother.
You get hurt!
We're just going to ease into those kind of things. And Jesus doesn't let you do that. I promise you. The moment you open your heart and you kind of, we're just going to ease into it. And people freak out because it's like do or die. But you know what? If you study the life of Jesus, that's what happened. Jesus offended a lot of people in the religious elite. He didn't offend the worldly people. Because worldly people want to know, if it's God, I want it. If it's not, I don't. Religious people like, I just don't want it. God doesn't care about that. But he is planting seeds. He's planting seeds in each heart. Even if you don't like it, there's a seed he plants in the heart. And I'm telling you, he will offend. So, let me go back 3 or 4 stories here. So we're in my apartment, and those 3 girls dropped to the ground. And I had to make a choice. Am I going to stop this? Or am I going to let God do what I asked him to do? And thank the Lord that I chose to let him do what he wanted to do. And ever since that time, we've had God do miracles. Every service. Presence of God, the presence of the Holy Spirit. And that's what this is about. And Holy Spirit can do more in one instant than we can do in a lifetime of our own efforts. He can do more in an instant with one touch. That girl that's laughing right there, she was so messed up, and I'm not going to embarrass her. I mean, you don't even know the stuff that she's been through. She's been through the worst stuff you can imagine. And Holy Spirit touched her and heals her. And she's been healed of hepatitis C, to the point they can't even discover what kind it is. She stopped throwing up, she stopped having fever, stopped having the lesions, completely disappeared, holds down a job now, totally happy, no fatigue. All the hurt, all the pain. If anybody should have pain, it should be her. She's ask her personally. And God is healing her over and over. And this is how revival starts. So if you came just for a sweet little message, go listen to a podcast. We came to have refreshing from the Holy Spirit. So, I got one verse too, right? I'm talking about women. That's right, see what happens when you talk about women. Holy Spirit loves women. He loves women. And it's time we honor women. It's time men catch up with God. It's time we stop using the submission to authority and misusing it. And instead, we lay down our lives for the women, as Christ laid down his life for the church. And if you do that, I promise you that a woman will submit to a dead man. Because they're just looking for a leader. They're not looking for a one to lay the Lord over. So, there's a generational blessing that Timothy has from Eunice and whatever the other lady's name is. Lois. There's got to be a Clark Kent in there somewhere. Thank the Lord, I really only have one verse to say. I only have one more verse to get through. And so he says, I'm sure that it's well with you. For this reason. So do you notice these two are connected? For this reason. He says, verse 6, I remind you to kindle afresh the gift of God which is in you through the laying on of my hands. For God has not given us a spirit of timidity, but of power, love, and a sound mind. Go back to verse 6. He says, I put, therefore, because of these women in your life, because of this generational heritage of the Holy Spirit in your life, I tell you to bring into remembrance the gift of God which was put into you and kindle it, the New American Standard says, to stir it up, other translations say. To stir up the gift of God which is in you by the putting on of my hands, by the laying on of hands. So how do we do this stuff out on the street? You know, you're hearing all these testimonies about people being healed, about people being delivered, about people's blind eyes opening, and you're all clapping for that, but this might be offending you. But I tell you, it's this right here, and submitting and stirring up to the presence of God, that stirs up those events out there. And so Paul is saying, remember to stir up and kindle. And when you kindle and you stoke a fire, you need to stoke it, and you get it going. And this is how you stoke it. You say, Jesus, every day you come to him. The one who abides in me, I will abide in him, and I will cause him to bear much fruit. For apart from me, you can do nothing. So you kindle the fire of God in your life. And if you have Jesus, then that is in you. But it may just be embers. You may just be here tonight and you have embers, and that's why you come. These two don't have embers. They're fanning a flame. And I watch her go lay hands on the sick, and I watch them recover. And if you, this is the last little warning I will give you. If you're criticizing that, how many sick people have you healed? How many demons have you cast out? How is your walk? Are you walking in holiness? Because I tell you, it's this. It's the Holy Spirit in all of his presence that takes you into those things of Jesus. There's only one way, and it's to humble your heart and the humble receive grace. There was a revival. There are many revivals, and this is how they break out. And they go for 20 years, some of them. 30 years, 40 years. We want one that's sustained. And so Holy Spirit, just come right now, get on Star. Everybody put your hand towards Starlet right now, on the blue star. In the name of Jesus, we release joy over her right now. Holy Spirit, just get her. Woo! we stir you up, Jesus. Thank you, God. We fan the flame. Will you just put your hand on your neighbor, on their shoulder? And everybody repeat after me. Say, Jesus.
Jesus.
Get him. Jesus, we just give you these sermons. This is yours. You're a better minister. So we're going to invite you up in a minute. If you need a healing in your body, if you want to get saved, if you want to try it. Did you know that the disciples didn't attend the University of Jerusalem? They didn't attend U of Jew. Jesus picked fishermen. He picked uneducated. I'm not saying you can't be educated and be in the Lord. I have some myself. But you have to submit your intellect to the unseen, to the supernatural, or you're not going to go anywhere. And God will just keep pounding you until you submit that pride and that I know it all and I'm educated and this is undignified. David said, I have become even more undignified than this, rips off his robes, dances in the middle of Jerusalem. And the one person who criticizes him in her heart was barren because of it. She couldn't bear children because she made fun of a person who was liberated in Jesus. Now, if they're going after the devil or they're going after some other spirit, that's a different thing. But Jesus said, you will know them by their fruit. And the Bible says, you will know. This is how you recognize the Spirit of God. Any spirit that comes and he says that Jesus is Lord and that Jesus has come in the flesh is from God. Every spirit that does not confess that is from the Antichrist. That's it. What name is it in? What fruit does it bear?
Yeah.
Is it bearing fruit of righteousness? Is it bearing fruits of works of Jesus? Then it's the Spirit of God. You may not like it. It may be totally outside of your comfort zone. But it is this that brings Jesus into the world. Yeah.
I was raised Baptist, and I can remember when the move of the Holy Spirit was going on, and it was laughter, and I made a judgment against it. You know, I thought, oh, that's not proper. But there has been a spirit of joy in this place ever since I walked in it. And I want to say something. At my age, I'm around a lot of unjoyful people. And I have a question to ask you. I am a serious person, but I am a jokester. And I have laughed at him all night long. And you know what? People pay for this kind of comedy. And if you're sitting here, I want to ask you a question. When was the last time you had joy? When was the last time you had joy? And God gave me a prophecy probably 35, 40 years ago. And he said to me, in the last days, they will know me by the peace and the joy and the love that they have. And you go around people are unhappy. I mean, that's serious. People are really unhappy. I went through unhappy times. You know, when my husband passed away, you know what the song the Lord had me sing? What I learned in Bible school? I've got the joy down in my heart. I've got the peace that passes understanding down in my heart. I kept singing that song over and over because I was decreeing it in the atmosphere that the devil wasn't going to take from me what the Holy Ghost had already given me.
That's right.
So tonight, I just know that ever since I've been in here, I've had to contain myself. Because this is the driest comedian that there is, and I have been up here laughing and laughing, and you know what? I needed that laughter. I needed tonight. So I just say, I challenge every man, because I think it's harder on you. Ask yourself, how much joy do you have? Because I'll tell you something, the Holy Spirit gives way more. Holy Spirit gives way more than just us. And it's one, we need to heal. We need to do that. But you know what? You may be the carrier of the joy of the Lord that somebody needs that you're around.
We've said this many times before. How many of us can go to a basketball game or a football game and do what you guys just did, scream your heads off?
I can do it.
She can do it. I don't doubt that. And you can go and just scream your head off for a bunch of people who are playing sports. And I like sports.
I'll see my joy win.
But we have to transform our mind. Because God is the originator of joy and of love and of peace. And if you can go to one of those places and scream your head off, but you can't do it for God,
amen.
Guess whose issue it is? So church has always just been a bunch of people who believe in Jesus getting together and fellowshipping and worshiping God. There are serious moments. There's a moment tonight. There was a reverent spirit in here earlier. And that was serious, and it was beautiful because it was serious. In heaven, there's a moment where it says that nobody speaks for a long period of time. And that's holy. But we have a lot of silence going on in the church that isn't even holy. It's just religion.
Right.
And so there's a moment for that, but then there's a moment for joy.
Yes.
And one of the gifts of the Spirit, I mean one of the fruits of the Spirit, is joy. And so how is joy most expressed? You know, people, theologians will argue, well, that's joy the Lord, not laughter in the Lord, brother. Well, how many times have you had joy and you not laughed? I mean, laughter is a pretty prominent part of joy. I just have the joy of the Lord. I'm just so full of joy. That cheer's out of place. Come on, that's ridiculous. Joy is part of his nature. So, I just welcome you, Jesus, to do whatever you want to do. The word that I had for tonight that I didn't tell you was there were times of refreshing coming. And I knew that I was supposed to talk about that. And so I'm just going to end with that. That Jesus says there are times of refreshing.
Yes!
And so I want to read this scripture to you that has to do with that. And this is right after they've healed the beggar by the gate, Peter and John, and they bring him before the Sanhedrin. They get in trouble. They did something supernatural, so they got in trouble. Got called into the principal's office, or the religious leaders. And so he tells them, it's by faith in Jesus that this has happened. And then he says to them, therefore, repent and return to Christ, so that your sins may be wiped away, in order that times of refreshing will come.
Yes.
And so, what do we do first? We repent. But what does that mean? It means to turn from where you are. If you're not fully focused and fully into Jesus, and your eyes aren't single-gazed, and everything in your heart isn't after Jesus with everything you got, and if there's stuff in your life you haven't given and surrendered, and he says it's time to lay it down and to turn your eyes onto Jesus, who is the author and finisher of your faith. He is everything, the Alpha and Omega. His cross says, come and die so that you can live.
Yes.
And so he come to the cross and come and lay it down. And he says the moment you do that, you open yourself up to the times of refreshing that you were born for. That's what we were birthed for, is to be refreshed in the Lord and to be fresh. I mean, to be refreshed just means that you weren't fresh. So let's just stay fresh.
Amen.
The Holy Spirit is fresh. He's going to get fresh with you tonight. So, Jesus, We just invite you now into this place. I want you to just bow your head for a moment. And I just invite Holy Spirit into your heart right now to examine your heart and where you're at. Where are you at tonight? Have you surrendered your all to Him? Have you surrendered your pride? Have you surrendered the sin? Because God is not here to condemn you. He's here to set you free. He's here to refresh you. He's here to fill you with the power of the Holy Spirit. A spirit of love, of power, and a sound mind. If you've got stuff going on in your mind, depression and fear and anxiety, He's here with one touch to break it off so that times of refreshing would come tonight. If you've got unforgiveness and bitterness, one third of the demonic stuff that we see cast out of people has to do with unforgiveness and bitterness. And the moment they lay that down and they submit it to the Lord and they offer blessing to the person that they were holding it against, this stuff just flies off of them. And they're filled with refreshment from the Holy Spirit. So Jesus, I thank you for what you're doing here. God, we submit to it. We take any persecution that the world has to offer for it, because your glory is worth it. From the very beginning, that was our heart, Lord. And we're not trying to be arrogant or know-it-alls. Lord, I just know that you have everything. It's all in you. And I would rather be a friend of God and an enemy of the world and an enemy of the religious crowd. Lord, get the religious crowd. We bless the churches of this area. We bless everybody in this area. Jesus, I pray that you bring the church into one accord. Lord, that we would come into your glory together. We get single eyed on your presence. Single eyed on Jesus. Lord, come right now and minister to every heart. We're not here to come against anybody. We're here to bring them in. Even in correction, there is a reconciliation. It's a drawing into love. It's a drawing into unity. It's a drawing into freedom, God. And I thank you that we all love each other. And you love us, Jesus. That's all there is. That's all that's important. So if this is you tonight, where you just want to lay down whatever is keeping you from the fullness of God, He's calling you out tonight, and He's saying, I want you, I want you, I'm not mad at you, but I need you to lay that down so that I can touch you, so I can give you freedom, so I can release you. And there is no exception. You are no exception to the cross. The blood is bigger than any sin. The blood is bigger than any exception you think you have and anything you've been through. This lady over here that's weeping over on the, or I'm sorry, laughing all night long. She's been through so much. And if when she's ready to share all of it, you're going to have your mind blown to how awesome God is. And if He can deliver her, if He can deliver others here who've been through it, He can deliver you from anything. So Jesus, we just welcome you to move on hearts tonight.